ladies and gentlemen, to sharpen business strategy, we're going to discuss on a lot of topics today. And the first topic for day two is taking a stalling ship to a cruising speed. Cogitate, revamp, sustain, an opportunity for MSMEs. And the first respected speaker of day two is the Group Chief Executive Officer of WNS Global Services, a NYSE-listed company in the business process management, BPM, business. He's also the Vice Chairman of NASSCOM. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome, with a big round of applause, Mr. Keshav R Murugesh. A round of applause. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everyone. And it was so nice to hear our old friend Omkarji speak and talk to us about all the kind of initiatives that the government has created to encourage all our businesses, not just the SMB business. So thank you very much, sir. And we always look forward, you know, to your support. So before I start, I must say one thing very clearly. The whole of yesterday, we heard various speakers come and say that Calcutta is my favorite city. I hope you all heard that. Let me tell you very clearly, I spent 15 years here, you know, running many businesses for ITC. So I'm very clear that this is my favorite city. I hope that discussion is now sealed and solved. So it's really great to be back in this wonderful city and to be interacting with, you know, all of you. This is a city which has shaped me personally. This is a city that has, you know, has the most interesting people, the most diverse in terms of talent, most wonderful cuisines. Everyone knows, you know, which is the home of the rasgulla, though I know the Oriyas have tried very hard to grab it from you guys, but now GI status has been given to Bengal. And most importantly, I remember, you know, when I was here years ago, I would wake up in the morning sometimes hearing this cholbena, cholbena, band, band culture. Twice I received letters of commendation from the vice chairman of ITC for coming to office on a band day. Right? For me, it was very simple. I stayed at Gurusade Road, so I had to just take my morning walk like Kamal takes every morning, reach my office, and there was nice tea, nice meal for me to eat. I hung around for a few hours, I went back, but I got two commendation letters. But that was Calcutta of those days. Today, I'm so proud to see that when there was band in other cities, Calcutta ran. And Kamal and the team made sure there was no disturbance to this event. So once again, I must heartily congratulate, you know, the state, the city, and each one of you who are present here in the audience. Now look, I have a presentation which is, which covers the MSME segment, as well as it has, you know, some stories on, hey boss, get the timer going, huh? I don't think you got the timer going. So it has stories on technology and stuff like that. But at the same time, I'm also conscious of the fact that whole of yesterday, many of you heard a lot of gyan on technology. Now, is that what you really want to hear? I'm happy to give you that. Or I can try and give you a little bit of it and just add some of my own personal stories, right, in terms of three companies I have worked for where I have helped to create $20 billion of market capitalization, right? That's quite a bit of money and wealth. So I'm going to try and do that instead of boring you with more of technology. I hope that is okay. So first, let me tell you, you know, we all know that technology is the way to go, right? If you just think of it, over the past few years, if anyone had told us about space travel, would we have believed him? No chance. But do you know, this Christmas, a SpaceX rocket actually delivered Christmas goodies to a remote space station. Are you aware of that? So it's starting to happen. Similarly, those of us who have read science fiction in the past and who have, you know, read some of these old stories involving computers and things like that will remember there have been a lot of write-ups about low-pressure tubes and fast-moving traffic through those tubes. That's what science fiction writers wrote about. Now think of it in a business context, a coming together of talent, some good technology, and most appropriately for the, you know, MSME sector, a business case has resulted in what we call today Hyperloop One, right? So some of the thoughts that we, you know, had earlier and we felt may not happen in the future, but these were, you know, thoughts that were very lofty, actually are very much possible. Technology and the technology disruption that goes with it is making all of this now possible and available to us. So I won't be surprised that over the next few years, if we are not talking about humanoids, then all of us actually making it available. So on that note, I would request you to quickly watch this video. Seen that, you know, game-changing business concepts and technologies are really transforming our lives. You know, earlier we spoke about driverless cars and IoT and things like that, but we have now moved to the next realm of change, and a lot of it is really driven by technology. And I must say, for every sector, whether you're micro, small, medium, large, or whatever, the ability to understand what is your business, appreciate what your end customer wants, and then leverage all the tools that go with it, including technology, are critical. Just rushing behind technology alone is not going to make any sense, if you ask me. But really focusing also on what is that business case, what is it that the customer wants that makes technology useful, is my core message here. Now, I just want to remind you of certain companies, right? I hope all of you remember Kodak, leader in its field, disappeared. Never saw, you know, digital camera kind of business coming in. Blockbuster Video, leader in its field, never understood that streaming and Netflix could have such impact on the company. And therefore, as a company, whether you're small, medium, or whatever, you have to ask that basic question. Am I going to just hold back and continue the same model and allow myself to be demolished? Or am I going to make that huge leap, which is a calculated change, calculated leap, and ride the wave? And I said I'll give you some examples of what I did, right? And I've worked at three companies, ITC, a company called Syntel, and now WNS. And I'll quick go back to 1989. ITC at that time was already a great company, but if you look at that era, was seen more as a tobacco and cigarette company, nothing else, right? The company had this huge, big excise case going against it, and all the time discussions were about that matter and the fact that this was now becoming a sunset industry as opposed to a sunrise industry. What was my role and what was the team's role? At that point in time, we created something called Investments and Diversifications Planning Group. We sat down together as a team. I used to work for the vice chairman at that point in time. And we said, this company has much more potential than just tobacco. We need to do many other things. And here are the assets we have. We understand technology. We have massive distribution. We have scale. We can put a new cigarette into every pawn shop within 48 hours, right? And I said, that is what we will leverage and create new businesses. And of course, we had a very strong wholesale distributor base. Remember, during those days, new companies were created, right? ITC, Agrotech. Remember the Sundrop brand? Used sour seed oil when whole of India was consuming groundnut oil, right? Completely new oil. Our farmers had a new seed to play with, a second crop. We went after and created an export-oriented company called ITC Global Holdings. We went into financial services. All of you will remember ITC Finance at that point in time. Number of businesses, ITC, ITC Threadneedle Asset Management Services. All of you who today invest in HDFC Mutual Fund, ladies and gentlemen, that is ITC Threadneedle Mutual Fund, the largest fund in India, right? Many of these were created during that time. And of course, the last company we created was ITC Infotech, of which I became employee number two. Lesson I want to mention here is, by the time we finished, you know, that journey over the next few years, ITC was no more known only as a tobacco company. It was seen as the most diversified company, as a company that had outstanding talent and had the ability to go after completely new areas. Personally for me, it was a huge learning because I understood customers much, much better. But my last assignment was creating this infotech company. And that is when I said the next 50 years will be driven by infotech. And that is where I want to spend my time. What did I do next? Went after the most risky assignment in the market because I said I want to go into pure IT. Company called Syntel went in there on the verge of closure because it was one of the pioneers at the time, had completely messed up in terms of strategy and changing with the times. But we cleaned up as a team. We cleaned up, corrected, made lots of changes, and fast forward over the next 9 years, took a market cap of 250 million to 4 billion when I left it. And those of you who are in the news or reading the news will remember that just 2 months ago, Syntel was sold to Atos at 4 billion, right? That's the kind of impact that was created by thinking through a business strategy, thinking through your core differentiation, and then executing. I'll talk about the WNS story later, but what I want to mention here is one must, irrespective of what sector you belong to, think of your strategy, think of your customer, and think of integrating the assets behind it. And I'll give you some examples of companies that have leveraged the whole technology disruption model very well in order to give high impact solutions for their customers. Do you know today that Airbnb is now using virtual reality technology to allow their customers to experience their hotel room even before they travel. What an impact for the buyer. Similarly, Amazon Go, which is their brick and mortar kind of offering, is allowing checkout free technology, which means you don't have to go to any cashier. You use your mobile phone, you check out, you do your shopping, you're gone, right? An Australian company called Curo, again, many of these started as small companies, but look where they are today. This company has created sensors that are present in a patient's room. So the patient now is being monitored even though the patient is not wearing a sensor, right? Nothing handheld or anything of that kind. The sensors are constantly sending out information to the company, as a result of which they are monitoring that patient's well-being, so to speak. We all know about Ethereum and how they are using blockchain to create enterprise-wide trust and not taxing the central systems. And very interesting example, Neiman Marcus in the US is actually using something called a white glove service. So if you're a shopper at Neiman Marcus and you go in there, they allow you to shoot 360-degree videos of yourself. They give it back to you, uploaded in an app. And when you go back home, you want to try on some dress, you want to try on a pair of jeans, a shirt, or whatever, you go to their site and you put their clothes on your body. You want to buy a purse, a woman wants to buy a purse, you can actually see that purse on your body, and then you can decide whether you want to buy it or not. So those are the kind of changes that are impactful changes that small companies have started creating. And today, ladies and gentlemen, these are no more small companies. They are large companies because they understood the customer. We all know about the impact of the MSME sector. We just had a short speech on that, so I won't go too deep into this. But all I want to say here is it is the lifeblood of India. If you just look at the statistics that I have displayed there, it is really the lifeblood. It has the potential to grow significantly. And there are many things happening for the MSME sector which can actually allow this sector to contribute even more. First and foremost, the government support. Omkarji just spoke about, the Mudra program and so many other programs. You can now take loans, you can get, the ability to manage your teams, your skills, things like that. With advent of 3G and 4G technology and leveraging analytics, you can do much more. Skills development has become such a big thing. You can actually go after NASSCOM's future skills platform. You can go after the NSDC program. You can go after the Prime Minister's, programs. And today, this sector has the ability to access social media to get after its marketing strategy, across the world. I want to remind all of us, this is a diverse country. And even today, even in terms of FMCG goods, there are some shaving creams, some toothpastes, and other products which are very well known in certain kind of cities or parts of the country, but may not be national brands. But they are very, very successful because those companies have understood the customer well, use analytics well, leverage technology exceedingly well, and then provide a solution that is driving, success for them. So therefore, what is my core message here? My core message here is, no more should we be only focused on driving efficiency, right, and productivity. That message is over and done with now. Today, the ability that we have, leveraging disruptive technology, analytics, and many other things, is really focusing on end customer experience. The customer is king. Remember what Mahatma Gandhi said. Customer is the only reason we exist. As long as we never lose sight of it, it's a very simple rule. And then behind that, we make sure that we have the right controls, the right efficiency, and the right effectiveness, I would say. And all around that, for our companies or the businesses we run, we are leveraging actionable insights through analytics. We are standardizing our processes so that there is no surprise from a customer point of view, and we are leveraging the right technology. I believe that technology is going to continue to be the important factor for the future. Technology is going to be all-pervasive. It will continue to make huge inroads. And as long as we say that technology disruption is an opportunity and not a threat for any sector, MSMB included, you know, we will continue to rule the roost. And again here, I actually believe that over a period of time, blockchain will become, you know, the platform of enterprise trust. I think, you know, the ability to leverage, you know, other technologies in order to be more impactful will only get better. And, you know, digital insight offered through artificial intelligence and other models in order to understand the customer better and provide an appropriate solution will only get deeper and deeper. While all this is happening, analytics and understanding the customer better cannot be an ad hoc kind of an insight, you know, kind of exercise. Analytics has to be leveraged enterprise-wide in order to understand the customer and provide much better end customer insight. And most importantly, I would say that the whole customer journey or the customer effectiveness path is going to be critical. And in this, personalization and driving new thoughts, leveraging technology is going to be critical. I'll give you an example. At WNS, the company I run today, when I went into that company, again, it was the leader in its segment. It had been created in 1996 by British Airways, did extremely well, very successful public issue in 2006. But by 2008, the strategy was not working because no more were customers coming because India had, you know, or Indian companies had created offshore centers. They were, customers were much more mature. They understood that they'd already got the value from cost arbitrage. They were now looking for new models. And for some reason, as a company, we had not made that change from a strategy point of view. It's 2009 when I came in, my team focused completely on this element. What does the customer want? How will our business change from a business process point of view in order to be impactful for the long term? And therefore, we dramatically changed our model, and we were the first company to go to a model where we said we will go domain-led, which means rather than selling processing services, we will sell insurance, healthcare, banking. And remember, the old was all about selling contact center, finance and accounting, things like that. It also meant we needed to completely change the DNA of the company in terms of the staff, in terms of investments in technology and things like that. And then we said every end customer has to be dealt with as a unique customer. So today, if you look at the way we leverage analytics in our entire business, I'm sure some of you who are members of, say, Jet Airways programs or Hilton or Intercontinental, some of these, you probably get emails that are tuned or focused only on you. You know, Mr. Such and Such or Miss Such and Such, you know, we are offering you a special program to use the hotel on Thursday and Friday because your data is actually available to those companies. And we are actually leveraging all of it to say that this person uses the hotel Monday to Thursday, but Friday to Saturday is a potential customer but is not using it. And we will send a mail to you saying, for you, $75 if you use it here. The person sitting next to you may get a completely different mail from the same hotel chain for the same hotel, saying Monday to Wednesday, you can use it because their usage is different. So hyper-personalized models is the way to go. And therefore, I would say customer centricity is critical. Again, what I want to say here is the ability to appreciate and understand that as an MSME company, the potential is huge is very, very important. I think I want to mention that, you know, in India already of our 12 million Kirana shops that we have, many of them are now starting to play a different game where they're understanding your buying patterns better. They're using at some level some rough kind of analytics to understand you better, understand what are the demand trends, understand what to stock, and that is actually a very positive thing for these companies. Many other, you know, things that are happening include, you know, leveraging social media for talent, for market access, and for positioning the brand. And we are seeing the MSMEs start to ride the digital wave. Now, why do we want this, right? I'm ending here soon, but why do we want this? Let me explain to you. Digital is critical, right? And if you look at an IDC study, I want to quote from that IDC study, it says that growth in digital has the potential to increase India's GDP by 60%, right? That's the first statistic. There's another study that has been done by KPMG as well as Google. It actually says that penetration of digital will allow profits of these companies to be double of offline companies. Similarly, creation and employment created by SMBs leveraging digital are 5 times that of offline companies. And the leveraging of this digital means SMBs have the potential to grow their share of GDP from 31% by another 10%, you know, and that's the kind of contribution they can make to the nation. So again, while ending, I want to say one thing. You remember many years ago, Charles Darwin said that it is not the strongest or the most intelligent of a species that will survive. It is the species that is capable of making the right change to survive. So for MSMB, everything is available now to us. You know, how are we making the change, leveraging all the good things around us to ride the economy? And again, why? I want to end by saying one more thing that Victor Hugo said. I'm sure many of you have seen some of his plays, but he said, for the bold, the future is only opportunity, right? That's the potential. So be bold, go after it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. And let me tell you that you're dot on time. Were you following that?
Yeah.
In fact, before time, yes. Thank you so much once again. A huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
Very good. Customized with your program. Absolutely.
Thank you.